Okay, hello again, everybody, and we're going to talk about how important it is for brushing before we actually do the groom. Now, this guy had lots of mess, and he still has what I lovingly refer to as a cotton soap. So there's all of these little pin mats that are throughout, but as an example of how tight the matting was, we could not work it in this area. I'm not sure. Let me see. Yeah. Move your head, buddy. Yeah. So this kind of bald spot was because the matting was so tight, I couldn't save the coat at all. And a portion of it is still here to show what we're working through. So, using the slicker brush to go through, I can immediately know that there's some here in the leg. Back you up just a little bit. So here in the leg, you can see he's looking at me. He's like, I don't know, what you doing? So I have this comb. Greyhound combs come in coarse and fine. This is considered fine. The tines are very close. So if I just make sure I'm making contact with the skin and come down, immediately I stop here. This is right about where the collar is going to be anyway, and so that's usually the first places we check as groomers for matting. And you can see immediately there's this large mat. So by holding the base of the mat and combing, I can minimize the strain to the skin and pulling that the dog experiences to work it out, and using the brush a little bit to brush the mat against my finger, I can get it to be released. So now I can comb straight through. I'm not fluffing like this. This makes you miss this, staying in contact with the skin, coming all the way through the coat will help you find where your mats are in these cotton coats. So when you have longer coats that are of this texture, you're going to experience with your client owners that areas of friction, come on, stand up, buddy. I know, it sucks. Will have more mats. So that's at the, if they have a harness, it's wherever the harness goes, behind the legs, under the legs, at the bend of the back of the leg, and then if they go a little east and west, he's not so bad, you'll have the inside of the legs get matted from friction. But, so, yeah, I know, that sucks. The other thing is these long feet, you'll find in between the toes, come on, let me just show. See how we have a big mat in between the toe here? And that's what he was alerting me to, that he felt tension. So I'm gonna try to pull it out with my fingers, like plucking it. Yes, I know you kisses, I know you want me to stop. But I have to, we gotta get through it. So utilizing the different tools to get through, but again, this is going to take a little bit of time. I've talked about matting in my learning to brush your curly coat dog line brushing video. So basically what this tutorial is going to be is for the novice groomer. And for the home do-it-yourselfer, you know, how do I brush my dog? And for education purposes is to understand why grooming shops are charging an extra matting fee, whether it's being clipped off or matted, because even when I clip off the mat that was tight to the skin, you can kind of see there's some red irritation here, and that's because the skin was being deprived of oxygen and blood flow because of the tightness of the mat, and removing that still can be dangerous because of how tight it can be pinching the skin. And we are using clippers and shears, and they're not intended to harm your pet, but it can also happen. So I'd like to stop here. Thank you. I didn't say hello, but hello, and thank you for tuning in to our YouTube channel. Please, if you like what you see, comment below. If you don't, comment below if you don't agree. Also, subscribe so you can see when we post new channels. I am trying to become more available so that I can do these videos to show kind of behind the scenes what happens and why things are the way they are and why you have fees like a matting fee. So I'm going to just pause and I'll be right back once we get all brushed out. Okay, so now I'm just double checking everything that I've gone through. I'm going to check each leg and foot on the inside. Underline or the under the belly, under the armpits. Make sure that. So even with that, you can see that's still little pin mats that were in what I've already brushed and combed. So even over the back of the dog, you can see there's more. So it's all. Most of the time you'll feel like it's never ending, but taking the time to go through and get all of these mats out allows you to give that fluffy haircut that this owner wants. Now, don't be confused. We do charge for matting because to demat this dog takes time, and time is money in a salon. Especially a salon that has multiple appointments and staff. If you're a one-man show groomer, you also know it takes time, and that is why you end up with a lot of people who end up with their dogs shaved, because to the groomer, the professional, or the part-time groomer, or whatever you want to call us, but as a business, I have to make the assessment, is it beneficial to the dog, or is it painful to brush out the dog? Is the dog going to tolerate the brushing? Is there going to be enough time in my day to, did I allow actually enough time in order to do this dematting? Those are all factors in calculating really how much you are going to be able to manage. We operate by appointment, so we allot a certain amount of time for a dog in good to decent condition. Now, when the dog comes in and has all these extra mats, this takes time. It's not what we had allotted for, so we have to charge because it sets our next appointments back. Which is also another video I'll be talking about, which is, you know, how to properly charge and explain charges. A lot of it has to do with your overhead. But to the average pet owner, if they don't show up for their appointment, they feel that it's okay. They called you the day of, or, you know, it's just one haircut. And to the business, staff showed up, I turned on the lights, I was here, my time is valuable, my staff time is valuable because I have to pay them. So when an appointment doesn't show up, we charge a no-show fee, and that fee is the base price of the groom. So no added extras, just what we normally would charge if the dog would have shown up. Because when we budget our days and book our days, we're booking for a certain amount of revenue to come in to cover all of our costs. But again, that's another video. So now that I've gone through and I've made sure that I can get my comb Still, I can get even more of these little pin mats, but for the best portion of this, I can get through every area. So now we're going to do our actual groom. So this little guy gets what people refer to as a teddy bear head and a teddy bear haircut. What does that mean? They want their dog to look like a toy, yes. More importantly, they want their dog to look young. So regardless of age, you can achieve this teddy bear. Coat texture is a player. If you have a very straight drop coat, you're not going to achieve a teddy bear. So this dog is obviously mixed, and so there's some, we can achieve some volume with the coat because there's some wave and curl, as you can see here. I do want to point out, before I go further, I'm not sure if the camera is going to catch this, but where the matting was on this leg, the coat texture is different than where there was no matting. And that happens because the hair follicle, or fur follicle, has damage because it was kinked up real tight. And then I had to release it. Even though we bathed and conditioned, it's still damaged from being so tight. So with this guy, first I'm gonna do his sanitary. So I'm using my wall 5-in-1, and I'm gonna go over his paw pads and make sure that we have exposed the paw pad, like so. You see his little paw? Yeah, buddy. So again. Now, I don't want to get this stuff just yet. I just want to get the paw pad itself. Now, I do know I'm going to, you see me taking some of this, my finger is at the back of the pad, so I can save some scissor time, and I'll do that same thing here. My finger's at the back of the pad, and anything hanging over it is what I'm gonna come off, so that we have nice clean paw pads. Hi! Alright, come on buddy, let me do your back ones. Do the same thing in the back. While I'm with this back leg, I'm going to do the under side into the tuck up a little bit. I come down the inner thigh. I like a nice, wide, clean sanitary. Most males will hike, but there are times that they don't. So when they squat, this helps keep them clean and longer. So when I come around, I'm going to do butt area again, so that way when he poops, he holds his tail up a lot, so it's a little easier to judge what hair is going to be in the way. When he goes to defecate, doing this, I'm bending. If you notice, this little guy does not, I'm not ripping his leg up. I'm the one who's the contortionist in this scenario because I don't want to put any extra strain in the joint. So natural motion is here. He already will lift his leg like so. So that's about as high as you would want to lift the leg. Now, for those who are wondering who groom, you know, what did I use? What setting on my 5-in-1? For somebody who's new, to the dog, not knowing how they're going to behave, and not knowing exactly how to handle the dog, then I would stick with a 10, maybe even a 15. But I use 30s and 40s on my regular clients to keep their feet in their sanitary areas cleaner longer. Especially these days and in the winter, people will stretch out their appointments. When they were in the summer, maybe every 4 to 6 weeks, now they're 6 to 8 weeks. Previously, nails were already done, so we've got nice short little nails. I don't know if they can really see those. So I don't have to do that. But what I'm going to do now is I'm going to start with the head and work my way down the body. I'm going to be using a zero guard comb on a 30 blade. You can use a zero guard comb on a 10, on a 9. What's the best one to use? Depends on the coat texture, so you can play around with that. If you're at home and you're kind of learning how to do this at home and you bought a clipper at Walmart, your plastic guards that come with those clippers is not the same as what a professional groomer is using in a salon. So when you tell a client, when a client tells me, well, I use a two guard on my dog at home, that's not the same length as what we use. But over time, I've learned what that translates to as far as pet grooming goes. So you can see how I come forward on the head to shape this, and I'm coming around under the ear, lift the ear up out of the way, go down the neck. Cotton coat, that's where that big mat was. Didn't want to really go through it. There we go. So, as you can see, there's a hole here. I have to ignore this so that we're not, because this client doesn't want her dog really short. So, sadly, there'll be that little bald spot. Thankfully, it's the ear kind of disguises it, so it's not as noticeable. If it was somewhere else on the body, I probably would be taking him a lot shorter. You can see we have another very short area here, because a typical place where mats happen is right behind the ear, because, oh, I'm going to love on my dog, and he just loves it so much. Well, all of that rubbing creates friction, which creates those mats. So a tip for home care is wherever you are super lovey on your dog, brush those areas first. Because 9 times out of 10 on a longer coated dog, you're going to have matting there. Okay. So, what I've just done is referred to as blocking in. I'm not done with this head. I've just got most of the length off that I need off. The rest I will shape with scissors. Okay, so now that I've done the down the neck, I'll go down the chest. And I'm going to follow the contour of the dog. Okay, so because of his cotton coat and my 30 blade under here is not wanting to travel through it well, I am going to switch. To a 10 blade under my guard comb. And now with the damaged coat from the matting, I can slip through a lot smoother. Now I want to point out, follow the spine all the way down, and then it's a swooping motion. You're not coming straight like this. There's an angle. Everything has a little bit of an angle because the coat doesn't grow straight down. It grows at an angle. So you have to follow the coat. So, following the coat, I'm working my way down. Follow the shape of the ribcage, which is contouring. Typically, rule of thumb is 3 passes in an area. But when you have a cotton coat and you're looking for smoothness, you might have to do more than 3 passes just because it pops up and it really is different. And that also applies to when you have damaged coat from matting, because it'll lay one way and then you put the blade over it and then it pops up because the bend of it is exposed. So now there's some length here. I think you can see this better on this leg. This area right here is all damaged coat from matting because it was very matted here. So I'm going to pick this up. So if you can see, there's little pin mats right in here from all of that matting, and yes, the clipper went through, the blade went through, I should say the guard comb went through, but they still exist, they're still there, they just happen to be a lot closer together, and we're able to slip through. So also, as I'm getting through this side of the dog, we will be having sessions where we go live, so please like and subscribe to our station. Leave comments, let me know what you think about how these videos are, what you want to see more of. So I'm going to pause again and I'll come right back once I'm done shaping up both sides. Okay, so now I am going to take care of this little guy's face. So first I'm going to use my blenders in the nose area here. In a minute we're going to have an actual camera holding person, so there'll be better shots of what I'm doing. Now, you can see his little eyes, yes, sort of. Okay, so I know some people are going to make a comment about my shears being on my table. Well, they're like that for the purpose of not having to reach so far during this video. Normally, I have them over on my station. So in order to carve out, this nose is the center of my circle. So I want to carve out these eyes for this visor. Don't you by trimming way back here, I can make this eye open up even more. And my curves, tip is away from the dog, like so. I know this makes a lot of younger groomers very nervous about being so close to the eye, hence the reason why the tip is always pointed away from the dog. And comb and cut. Everything is comb and cut. So now that I've got that, I am going to pick up that, no tongue. Pick up this center of the eye here. Now he has a little bit of a cowlick at the back of this eye. So I have to approach it a little bit differently to achieve the same look. Okay. So now if I put the ear up out of the way, there's the jawline. I have the imaginary jaw right under here. So I have to imagine where that jaw actually is. I have my buttercut curved blenders. Help under the ear to bring this under. Yes, I know. Just did that. You're silly. You is silly. Lower this over here. Okay. So, ear up out of the way. Alrighty. Oh, your ears need to be plucked. We'll do that after. Typically, plucking of the ears before the bath, so that way you can wash out any left behind ear powder. Another way to clean out the ear is with a clipper. I put my thumb over the actual ear canal to trim with my shears any hair. Yes, I know, before anybody comments, there is a lot of debate to pluck or not to pluck. It causes ear infections, it doesn't. I've plucked for years, and in my experience, the plucking of the ear hair allows more oxygenation in the ear, which as a result, if there was bacteria, then it gets a chance to actually flourish. So the air hair can trap bacteria, and you don't even know, and it just sits there and festers when there's nothing in the way holding it. I believe that that's why you can see, you experience more of the ear infection. If you know when you are plucking ears, they're really gooey and icky and have actual signs of infection, then yes, do not pluck. They have to be, I would clip it, so that way when they go to the vet and they get their medication and find out whether it's bacterial or yeast related, the medication actually gets down in the ear canal instead of getting trapped on top of the hair. So now, because he has a curly coat, I do treat it like a poodle. I do bring everything forward to shape it, over the visor especially. Don't twitch. Now, what does everybody do? They do this, they pet their dog, and they do this. So once I know I've achieved symmetry with the hair all the way forward, then I will push the hair back like the owner will and just pick up those little sticky outies that have, as you can see, when I push the hair back, it actually lays different on this side than it does over here. But pulling everything forward and fluffing, you have more idea of what this coat is doing. Yes, I know. Why you gotta be cocking your head on me again? Stop that. Okay. So He's dropping his head, which gives me the ability to see behind the ears. And I've got the loop dropped down on the neck, tethered to my groomer's helper for safety, but it gives me the ability to see more. You know, when the dog's down eating, you would see this back area if I was at home, which means so will the owner. So, see, picking up the air, you see all of this sticking out. Now I'm right-handed, so on the right side of the dog, it's a little harder. I gotta look over and scissor this way. Positioning your body and positioning the head so that you can see, always keeping in mind the comfort of the dog. So as I say, grooming is a contact sport. You are the contortionist, so to keep the dog compliant and pliable, it's better that I cut myself than I cut the dog, obviously. He is being fabulously good. Good boy. Now, clearing my table in between each thing that I'm doing allows me to have a clearer peripheral line of sight. And what I mean by that is I can use the background to give me an idea of what's going on when I look at the dog. So it's almost like looking past what you're scissoring so that you can see where you need to shape things up. So this is his little teddy head that mom likes. He's a little furry. Now, ear length, typically to the muzzle, to the end of the nose when I bring it forward, anything past the nose would be gone because that's going to end up in his food and his water bowl. She likes longer ears, so I will shape them. Kind of like the natural way the ear leather is shaped, and leave only the middle of the ear hair on the leather longer, which will allow for less in the water. But if he picks up his ears, it's still, when he drops his ears, there's see this like U underneath, so there's still some appearance of length, but it's easier to maintain cleanliness when he's at home. Now, pulling the hair out of the lip like I'm doing here, so all of these little hairs, he likes little flavor savers. I will trim those so you can see. Can you do this on every dog? No, because if they're super wiggly, you might cut something different. So you learn which dogs are good candidates for doing what I just did with shears. There's another little kissy face if you take your clipper and you just clean up right under the nose. A lot of dogs will look really cute like that. He has a pliable coat for even doing some Asian fusion. Kind of poofy nose and very tight under the chin. Okay, so I could nitpick all day on his head. Next, I'm going to move to the body and get my camera holder. And so now we're back, and I'm going to shape up his feet. So, shaping legs and feet. Your dog needs to stand on all fours. And see, the minute I put my hand under him, he does this little backwards lean. So first, I will use either straights or curves, but I'm a curve lover, so I can use my curves to make a straight line. And I go along the bottom of the dog's foot first, like so. The back side, I just pick up the foot. I've already scissored what I could see, so the little curl that you see there is what would actually be touching the table. So I'm gonna get rid of that, like so. Okay, so coming through, if you look from the back of the dog here, you can see what's sticking out in between both legs. So, from back there, you can see what I'm doing, scissoring the side to create a column leg. I'm going to come in from the front so because I can see better what I'm doing to the front of this inside. And I'm going to pick up this foot, and this allows me to, if you want to come over here so I can put my head in the way. This gives me the ability to do the inside of the leg, and he's still on three legs so that I can see what needs to be scissored. So, so there's our back shaped foot. Again, I can keep going. Now in the front here, we need to create the angle on the actual foot. So I find it easier to use my curves to accentuate the actual part of the foot and come around. We have more of a column here. Now, for his underline, we blocked everything in with our guard comb, but I'm going to neaten it all up now. So you can see now how this line falls, the contour of the dog. And then we're going to do this front foot, and then the same, and we want him to stay standing because then we see where the foot is naturally. So, no, stay, standing, stay. No. So because he's doing that, I'm going to pick up this foot, and my thumb is in the loop so that I can just keep it in a pretty natural place and help support him. Okay, so now I'm going to pick this up that I've done that. I'm just going to pick up these just a little bit. Now, if you would come over to the other side, you can see the front of the dog. So you can see this little guy, when he stands, his foot goes that way. He's got his foot's kind of like this. Same thing here, it's going that way. They call that east and west. Let's put it forward. So this is where corrective grooming comes in. And what I'm going to do is make the appearance that this is a straight leg and he is actually structurally sound, which apparently he is not. When you pet groom, there is a lot of dogs that go east and west like this. The trick is in corrective grooming is to give the appearance that that fault is not there. And sometimes you can do it and sometimes you can't. Coat condition plays a part, length of the groom plays a huge part in your ability to do this. So right now, do the inside of this leg, I'm gonna actually stop. Come over here. I'm gonna hold your head. Come in really tight on the inside where the leg sticks out to make the eye, to trick the eye. So even just doing that, I don't know if you can see that, it already looks like I've straightened out his leg, but I didn't. I didn't break his leg. But by doing that, coming in tighter here because it sticks out, and leaving this longer over here, it appears that he has a straight leg. And he really doesn't. So we have more . Incidentally, this area of his leg was extremely matted because of the way it is structurally, and where the friction of walking and holding on to his toys would be. So we're going to pause, and I'm going to do the other two, so then you can see what corrected legs, column legs, look like on a cotton coat.